Welcome to another Roll for Crit podcast, the official podcast for RollForCrit.com. Watch, shop, play. I'm Will Keeler.
I'm Jonathan Estes. PAX East has been going on lately, as has the festival in Cannes for their new board game announcements. I don't know if you know anybody who's going to PAX East or anything.
No one has told me.
But if you're there, enjoy. If you've played some board games, we'd love to hear about that. But that's not what we're going to talk about in today's show. just thought it'd be a good little bumper to bring you off with. But we've got some cool stuff to talk about, starting with Board Game Geek has unveiled the results for their 2016 Golden Geek Awards. Mm-hmm. They do this every year. They've been doing the nominations leading up to this. You could have voted. If you didn't, I'm sorry you missed it. But basically,
your favorite game didn't make it on because of that. Congratulations.
It's because of you that the Jar Jar Binks adventure game.
We were one vote away.
Sure, it didn't come out in 2016. Technicality.
It comes out every year.
hopefully it never comes out if you're lucky. Scythe basically swept the awards. It got best game, best solo game, best artwork, best strategy game. I have the full...
it's interesting because, I mean, it did sweep the awards, but it got a bunch of honorables. But there are a bunch of other games that I'd say made second place, the honorable mentions in a lot of categories too, so it's not like...
Well, maybe I didn't put down the runners-up, but I'll go over some of the bigger winners that we can talk about. Best two-player game was Star Wars Rebellion. Best card game was Arkham Horror, card game. Best co-op, Mechs vs. Minions. And most innovative, they gave to Captain Sonar. Probably makes sense. I know Codename Pictures got a couple for, like, Best Party, Best Family. I don't know.
The runner-ups, honestly, I saw were mostly Scythe, Arkham Horror, the card game, Mansions of Madness 2nd Edition. Mm. Those are really the, like, I saw almost, if they weren't centered, they were on the sides. Like, I think only Innovative with Captain Sonar was there, because Scythe was one of them.
right, I remember that.
And the other one was the only one was a game I didn't actually hear of. Like, everything else, outside of maybe Party and Family.
I mean, it makes sense,
there's a good
right?
chance that those three games, one of those three games are in it. I mean, it makes sense. And, I mean, we've talked about this with awards. If something wins best, it's probably going to, you know, hit a lot of
things. You also
have
to remember this is user-nominated,
right.
So unlike some like a official like at a convention or the Spiel des Jahres, this is based on what people actually have been playing. Mm-hmm. So a lesser-known game isn't going to get as... It's, like, you tend to see the biggest-selling games in this list. Right,
I mean, and not that we're saying that other games don't deserve it, but, I mean, I feel like there's a reason those games are in the second place or first in these categories in almost everything. I mean, you haven't played Mansions yet.
Correct.
But you've played the other two, and I'm pretty sure you've really enjoyed both
of them. Yeah, I mean, I looked at it, I was like, yeah, these are all good games. It did seem a little, I mean, there aren't that many categories. Mm-hmm. I'd like to see some more categories, actually.
Maybe I mean, that's always a thing with awards, too. When you break down, there's always one group that you think deserves that's not there. But right. I should mention that I know Runups Are Best was Terraforming Mars. Was one of them.
Right.
Blanking on what the third one is. But, I mean, that's the one other game, like, the two games that are on our miss list.
Right, our list of shame.
And Mechs and Minions, which I still think is pretty good, considering.
Yeah, we did pretty well. So, overall, a predictable, but mostly well-deserved, I think. I mean, there's not really a good way to solve this. Unfortunately, with board games, it's hard to be able to play a lot of them unless you're like,
I mean, like
even us.
We're proud that we missed those. And our shelves are filled with things like, and even though you play them, it's not just playing it once. There's so many games that we're like, we want to get 10 games of this in before we can really talk about it, but we don't have...
I wonder if maybe, things like Tabletop Simulator really expand and take off, maybe that'll be a good way for people to experience more games that aren't necessarily in print or aren't the most popular games.
I mean, that definitely will, but in the end, an hour is still an hour.
It's still an hour. It depends on what planet you're on or something, but yes.
But I mean, there's only so much time you can devote.
Yeah. Well, you can take a look at the full list. So we got the link down there and see if there's any you agree with or disagree with.
Yeah, I'd definitely be curious. I mean, I think overall, like I said, most of the things that I knew, I was like, yeah.
In game announcements, IDW has revealed that they are partnering with Atari to publish a series of board games based on classic Atari games. So far, they have announced Centipedes is going to be the first one in September, and will be followed by Asteroids and Missile Command. We don't know much about these games, but we do know that John Gilmore, who worked on Dead of Winter and other Plaid Hat titles, is going to be working on as designer of these games, which is probably a good sign, a good place to start. But we haven't really seen many games based on classic kind of arcade style games, at least not directly.
Yeah.
The one that I was thinking of is Battle at Kemble's Cascade.
I felt like in my head that it has the centipede.
Exactly.
Scrolling mechanic.
Yeah, or like it's sort of like Galaga.
Right.
But I think that game was pretty successful for what it set out to do. I liked a lot of things about it. So I do think that there could be something good coming out of this, probably. I don't know if I did not have an Atari. I think we were not born in that generation, but any games, so like these classic games that maybe you've played somewhere here and there. Like, I've played, Asteroids, Missile Command.
Yeah, I mean, I've played them and just...
That you think maybe somehow would translate?
Well, the weird thing is, when I think of them, it's sort of the, hey, I got a quarter, there's an arcade, I'm going to play it,
Right.
But when you say board game, mostly I think of, oh, hey, I'm going to go with Jonathan and Neil and play together. You think of just the nice single player not thinking then.
True.
So I'm very curious, are you all going to be in there together? Are we all fighting Centipede? Or are they all single player games? I think both of them would be reasonable choices. I don't know how they design them.
I hope that there is a solo mode. I'm thinking they definitely will be multiplayer because they have that. They want to sell these to the mainstream.
Right.
Say this is an Atari board game. Remember your childhood? Buy it in a box now. So they definitely want that. Missile Command could be, I think these concepts are so simple that you could almost expand them into anything.
Right.
Like Centipede, well, you're a centipede.
That's part of the reason we've seen the scrolling mechanic we said in Battle Cascade, and we're like, all right, so what else is there?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's a lot of interesting things that you could, different ways you could take those concepts. Mm-hmm. Asteroids, maybe the other players are asteroids.
Dexterity game.
Yeah, oh, that would make sense. That would be good, a dexterity game, yeah. I just hope that they come out with an E.T. board game, right?
Well, you get to actually bury it.
Or what's the one, is it called Pitfall? Or it's like the famous, it's like one of the first platformers where you're jumping
from
the ropes.
Yeah.
That's kind of hard to make into a board game.
It'd just be the Jar Jar Binks game just reskinned.
Oh, man. This is the Jar Jar Binks callback episode. Yeah, so I don't know. If there's any classic Atari games from your youth that you want
Well,
to
I
see.
Think the one other thing you mentioned is how curious the designer you mentioned, the game that you bring up is Dead of Winter. This is that one of the reasons we applaud Dead of Winter isn't the just for its game mechanics, so to speak. It's the story, the feeling that you're actually... So are we going to be like, the centipedes have killed my entire family. We're the last civilization left on Earth. Like, he somehow just makes this amazing story.
I really hope so.
It's actually, they all have crossroad cards.
That would be good. Maybe they connect. Maybe they're all part of one game system.
And then we get an Avengers movie or something with Atari games.
They could have done, an arcade box. And it's like, there's 5 Atari games in one. You can play them.
Well, I think what they would be a good thing, an interesting thing to do, probably because it'd be cheap, would be because I know a Portal comes a key for Portal 2 with it.
So Portal, the video game.
The board game.
Oh, the Portal board game
comes with a key for the video game.
Right.
So these should come with, keys for the video game.
Honestly, yes, they should. That's not a bad idea at all. Well, we'll see. I don't know. It'd be interesting. Maybe next they'll partner with, I don't know, Sega. I don't know. I mean, IDW's licenses have been very hit or miss. But it's at least they got someone good on board, so that gives us good hope for it. But maybe you like your video games a little more modern style. Well, this is pretty cool.
All right, this I don't know about.
So. Yeah, well, why partner with a board game company when as a video game company you could make your own tabletop game?
Because it's expensive?
That's why this next team actually did partner with it. I sort of misled you on that one. But, so... Harmonix, the people who created Rock Band and the original Guitar Hero, they are working with Hasbro to come out with a new board game, tabletop card game, I guess, not really a board game, that is called a drop mix. One word, drop mix. And we don't know a lot about the specific details yet. They just announced it, but you can see this weird thing behind us. And basically,
of course, we have a unique device that you have to buy from us to play the game.
Yeah, it's their bread and butter. You are going to connect this thing to an app, and you're going to have different cards, and the cards are going to represent different songs, real songs. So they actually released an initial track list.
Okay.
So there's stuff in
so
there.
Do they have chips in them?
I think either that or it's a code that it reads. I mean, it connects to the app, so it has something, some kind of data. And each one you put in the lineup will be either the vocals or the bass, you know, kind of like a music game, I think. So basically, what you're doing is you're creating mashups, sort of, or playlists with your friends. And somehow, some way, the cards are going to equate to points. And when you play enough to get enough points, you win. And they've also said that you'll be able to save the playlists or mashups that you make when you're done. So there's still a lot. Like, I was very confused after reading the description because I still don't really understand. Like, are the songs going to be playing the whole time? Or is it as you put the cards in?
So... are you just gonna hear the final product, or is it gonna be like you just hear the drums first, and then all of a sudden you hear the guitar?
Yeah,
or
I don't know, because it sounds like a lot of things to live up to.
It definitely does. And I also imagine playing it like you're playing with, let's imagine four slots.
So far they've announced 1v1 and 2v2.
Okay.
So you could play with four players.
Well, the reason I was saying that was like if you each played a card, like you're all trying to work together to make something sound nice, and you're like this, you just imagine, and then one person just drops like the worst lyrics ever you can think of. It's like, no!
It just ruined the song for you. That would be a good take. I'm thinking there's probably going to be a solo mode because it just looks like the kind of thing that would have that. And from a video game world, I think they would probably want to have
and
that.
And definitely, the other thing I'm curious about is I know a lot of music games that are still around, one of the big pushes is because people can upload their own music. And I don't mean like in the sense of like, this is my song I wrote, but more along the lines of like, you know, I'm a fan of TV show theme songs, so I'm going to put those on there. Or I'm more of a fan of music from this country, so I'm going to put...
That would be cool.
But it's impossible. No, I understand. Yeah. I'm just saying like... I wonder if there's going to be maybe a mode where you can somehow program them as something in the app. Like, if it is just scanning, like a bar, not an actual chip, then that could be possibly just print out.
Well, I think they're definitely going to sell, like, DLC expansion packs with new songs.
Oh, of course they are.
It's kind of funny.
Have you played Rock Band?
Like, they're actually going to have a Rock Band store, but for a physical card game. It's a crazy... It almost seems, like, insane, but at the same time, how did it take them this long to do this? Because they've done so many other... Like, they have the DS one with the little
because
grip.
Because they only focused on the game console.
But if you want to know some of the tracks, I mean, it's gonna have the hits.
Right. Oh boy,
you're gonna have Sia in there, Chandelier, Childish Gambino, Cake, Europe, Final Countdown, Jackson 5, Megan Trainor, Carly J. Repsen, all the hits.
So when I want the Beatles, I'm going to have to buy an all-new copy of this game. Not just the cards. Another one of the game packs.
That's just like standard procedure for board games. They're going to be right at home. The Lovecraft drop mix with like Gregorian chants and weird other language.
I just imagine you don't know people are playing with that, so everyone's like, I play like the guitar from this song. I play like the lyric, like all the pop music in that song, but I play Gregorian Lovecraft chants.
Yeah, I think it'll be good. Well, this comes out in September, but they've promised that there will be more information leading up to it. I'm very curious to find out how it actually plays.
Yes, but moving on, of course, as we talked about earlier, games just constantly releasing things. Cryptozoic!
Yeah, they're having a lot of fun, so you'll like this.
I know all about it.
they've announced their first organized play kit for the DC deck building game, and it's coming out this summer. And you can see that's the lovely playmat behind us that you could be a winner of.
Yeah, the winner gets that playmat, which I think is really awesome because, in particular, while they have had multiple playmats, only one of them has had, if you look in the bottom corner, you can see like the places for VP tokens or frozen tokens, which only came in the villain set. So only the villain playmat has that. Which is like, it's cool, but you know, I want, this has, you know, the cast.
Yeah.
Like, which is really awesome. The other big thing is there's a card, like a big character card. You get Vixen. And I've looked at it along with some of my other friends who play the game more. We find her really powerful. Like, her thing is pretty much reveal top card of the deck, and depending on what it is, you get a good ability.
Okay.
And because of that, and it hits every card type, she can adapt to whatever anyone else is doing. She doesn't get, like, hurt because no superpowers are coming out, or because no equipment is coming out, or because Superman's already getting all the superpowers. Like, she can adapt to anything.
Do you think she's OP?
I mean, I need to try her out before I do that.
Yeah.
The other big thing that I'm excited about, which is sort of funny, and I'm a little sad about at the same time, mostly because Legendary said they were going to do it. They've announced a big box will hold it all, which I'm happy because it's behind Jonathan actually over there right now. My box holding all the Cryptozoic deck building games, which includes the Hockey, Hobbit, Naruto, it's full. It's pretty much, now I can take all the DC out, just have it all there.
That is nice. I mean, every game that sells well enough that has that many expansions should have that.
Well, I mean, when Smash Up released theirs, we thought that was like...
of that box. The game.
No, that made the game worth it for the box. I mean, my brother bought the box to hold Magic cards. I'm amazed. I'm excited to get that. And honestly, I'm like, I wonder, depending on how big this is, we might want to do for a Legendary. Like what my brother did. Like, you know, we'll just get in and just put pictures, paste the picture for Iron Man over Batman.
It's the same. I do know they also announced that for their next kit, the promo card is going to be of Black Lightning.
Interesting.
Don't know what it looks like yet, though, but that's kind of neat. So, yeah, I don't know if anyone out there is going to be participating. Let us know how you do if you win one of these cards.
And what you think. Like I said, we thought it was really strong. Whether it's OP or not, I don't know. You can let us know.
Yeah. Should they Nixon Vixen? Wait, it sounds like I'm talking about Nixon. I don't know. It's weird. Okay. Kickstarters. Only a scant few Kickstarters to talk to you about this week. One of them is...
pretty big.
Ginormous. As big as perhaps a celestial... star. I don't know.
You're talking about the star in Orion's belt, aren't you?
Yes, I am. No, we're talking about Rising Sun from Cool Mini or Not. Often we kind of avoid these giant Kickstarters because we feel you've heard about them already, but...
also because it's not really a Kickstarter as much as here's a product.
Right. It really is like a pre-order. There's one tier for this game and costs $100 to back it.
Yep.
But if you don't know Rising Sun, it is from designer Eric Lang, and it takes place in ancient Japan, and you're all different types of factions and groups vying for power in Japan. It's basically like a territory control war game, but there's also a lot of other elements. There's like a resource gathering, there's... what I think is really cool, what I'm excited about, is there's also a bidding phase where it's completely secret and you don't actually know what your opponents are bidding on until you both reveal. So you might like put a bunch of coins in one thing and it turns out they didn't even go for it and you wasted your money, so you can try to psych each other out. There's also alliances. So you can form alliances, then you can betray the person, but you will lose honor if you do that. So a whole lot. It's one of those games that has everything.
I didn't even know, but apparently I already backed it.
Isn't that crazy? It's made a bajillion dollars. I think that's
And it's only been around like how many days?
Yeah, not many at the time of this recording. So check that out. I'm sure it will be a game everybody likes. It's gotten tons of buzz.
Who knows? Maybe it'll be the next Scythe.
Could be. Ooh, wow. We're calling it now. Oscar pick. Okay. And then on the complete opposite end of the spectrum, here's a game that I thought looked cool called The Lady and the Tiger, which is only $9. If you don't have the cash for Rising Sun, maybe you'll settle for this one. I liked it because it's based on this old story about there's like two doors, and one of them has a lady behind it, one of them has a tiger behind it.
Is this the old riddle with the two guardians?
I think it's similar to that. Okay. It's related, but it's not
It's not the one of us is lying, one
right.
of us is the truth.
It's kind of like that, but a little different. Mm-hmm. They Might Be Giants actually did a song based on that, too. But it's a two-player game, quick 15-minute thing where each person gets a card. You're either going to be a red lady or tiger or a blue lady or tiger.
Okay.
And... if, say, you're a blue tiger, then your goal when cards come out is you want to get a set of either four tigers or four blue cards of any type. And the other person, based on which cards you're taking, is going to be trying to guess what you are.
Okay.
And if they guess correctly, they get points. And if they guess incorrectly, you get points. Or if they never guess, etc. So it's sort of a round-based game where you get accumulate points. Only it's like 15 minutes to play. I thought we've been having a lot of fun lately with these, like Tides of Time and Hanafuda, that we've been filming all these little short two-player games. This
right.
seems to fit in that niche.
I mean,
niche.
As we talked about earlier with the all the awards, there's only so much time, so it's sort of nice to be able to be like, we actually played two games today.
Yeah, exactly. And the artwork looks really cool. It's very stylish. So check out The Lady and the Tiger and Rising Sun. They're on Kickstarter right now.
We had a busy week, so we didn't really get to do much for playing games. But I did get to try out the single player for Defenders of Soma. This is a Kickstarter I was really excited to get. It's actually based on actual diseases and medication, and as if they were actual monsters and heroes. And the idea is it can be either single player, which is what I did, which I'll talk more about, or a two-player game, where one person controls the virus beasts, and one person controls the heroes, which are medication.
Okay.
And each medication has a color, like a class of where the medication actually would belong, so like all the opioids or whatever. And a number. And the viruses have a bottom banner, which will say, like, this can be defeated by either anything that's yellow, a blue 4, or a red 1. And the idea is you want to match up and try to kill them while there's villagers in the center who the viruses want to kill. If the virus kills 3 villagers, they win. If the heroes can last 8 rounds, they win.
So villagers, so we're in the past in this game.
Yes, it's sort of medieval, but the actual matchups are based on what actually would help with that disease and stuff. And the diseases actually are somewhat trying to make sense of what they do. Like, some of them are opportunists. They only attack if someone's wounded. The idea being, like, it's the kind of things you might get if you get an infection. Hmm. When others, if they're defeated, mutate into, like, the really strong, deadly viruses, like, they become resistant to a lot of things. There's also, if you play a lot too much of one color, like if I keep playing the blue cards, there's a resistance pool for the viruses, so they can become resistant
they actually
against that
adapt.
Color. Yeah, so it's a really cool back and forth mechanism.
That's a good little mechanic to keep you from. It's sort of like a fighting game, making your move weaker if you keep mashing
exactly.
the same
so
combo.
It's really fun to think like, and there are ways to stop it from like. They have like usually 2 to 3 strikes on them in essence. So I'd be like, okay, before I play this, I'm gonna play this one, which makes it so I don't play remove a cube on my next one. So then I can make it so I don't see that often. So it was a lot of fun with this matchup and beautiful artwork. The other cool thing where I want to really play this is actually play with my friends who are currently in med school. Because the virus cards, like I said, they're named whatever their disease and the cure. So if I played the viruses, they give you a little mask to cover up the banners. So the person playing the medication, who would be my friends in med school, have to actually be like, I know penicillin stops that. So they actually have to think more. So I thought that was just amazing how this game actually takes an actual like study and application and brings it to this fun game mechanic.
So you could use this to teach medical students.
I mean, a little bit, yeah. I mean, I'm not thinking this is going to be the next medical textbook.
If your doctor is like, don't worry, I've played this game a lot.
I've won 2 games of Defender of Soma. I think I can handle this.
How would you, for people who haven't played this game, it sounds kind of like Pandemic. How does it compare to that in terms of gameplay and feel?
Well, it's a little, like I said, because it's not a cooperative game like Pandemic, it's not like we're just working together and viruses are just the cover-up. I really do feel a bit more into thinking like, oh, that matches up there. There's a lot more thinking about like that. It's more like a back and forth, because you'd be like, okay, I need to think, how do I play these cards to defend against your viruses? Mm-hmm. And then you're like, okay, how do I force him to give up this card with my virus abilities, or make it so I can start getting this resistance out and just run over him? So it doesn't play, I think, like Pandemic. It's not just like, oh, look, it's Pandemic. What? It's much more like a chess game, I would say. But in an educational, really cool way, that isn't just, this is this virus. There's actually like, you know, I can't think of any off the top of my head, but like amazing artwork like explains like why, because like the deadliest virus is the dragon. Obviously, it's like can only be killed by like one card.
Wait, is it actually a dragon?
Yeah, no, like the artworks of all the viruses are like dragons, ogre,
oh,
like
okay.
And like dripping and like E. coli is like this annoying little goblin and stuff.
I like it.
So I mean, I thought it was just a fun game, even if you're not that much, you know, you're not medicine. But if you are into, like, pre-med or medicine, I definitely think it's something worth checking out.
Sounds like a fun, another fun little two-player, mm-hmm. potentially, little game. Let's do a few viewer comments before we get to one final sort of thing that I thought was interesting to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So a few viewer comments. Tuga Geek asked the question concerning the app that came out for Descent a while ago that lets you play some campaigns where the app is actually the Overlord. Mm-hmm. Wanted to know if there's any news about whether Fantasy Flight plans on making the box campaigns playable with the app. I looked into it and I have found no such information. So at this time with that app, you're playing the app made campaigns, and not, if you want to play the ones that come in the base set, you still got to use the actual base set.
Yeah, my guess is they're like, if you want to play that, you use that. Like, if you want to play with someone being the Overlord, you use that. If you want to play without someone, we have an app for that.
I guess they would probably have to do some balancing and tweaking that they don't feel like doing.
I mean, like, also programming how the things...
But if they charged for it, because they do have some paid stuff in there, it seems like it could be
worth
it.
I don't know. I think the other thing is other people might get angry that the base they have to pay again for.
Mm.
I don't know.
Yeah, tough call. But
then again, also, they did it for Mansion Madness. They actually did, so... Mm. It's not like it's the first time they've done...
Maybe now that they've done more of that, maybe they've got their feet wet. Maybe they'll go back to it. There we go. Rogue Shadow had some thoughts about the whole Fantasy Flight debacle with Star Wars Destiny and their print runs being lessened. He said, I don't think the tourney scene will be killed, as those players will be the ones dedicated to getting cards the most. I think it might kill the casual scene, as who wants to play casually if you can only get cards as singles and can never find packs? My area has tourneys 3 to 5 nights a week, but I can't find a casual group to chuck dice weekly with. I think, yeah, that's a good point. Makes sense.
And I think that's probably true, but I think that while a tournament scene can be big, I think... if you don't have a casual scene, it'll sort of just become a really small niche.
Well, yeah, because you don't get the tourney scene without someone first starting as a casual player.
Magic is a big tourney scene, but there's a lot of casual play, you know, the Friday Night Magic. If you look at video games, you know, Overwatch is getting a big scene, but a lot of it is because there's also, like, the console casual players and stuff. Like, I think you need both markets.
Yeah, it is.
And you can have both markets. The casual and tournament people can be together.
The jury's still out on that one. But no, it is, it's kind of like an ecosystem.
Yeah.
You mess with one, it's going to have effects on the rest of it as well, yeah.
The hunter and the prey.
We'll see. And we also talked about the Buffy game last week. One of our sort of gripes was concerning the mechanic where you do a test, and if you flip a card and it's the wrong symbol, you just lose. Kevin B. Smith on Board Game Geek said, what bothers me about the resolution system, and what might bother you as well, is that if you fail, you also lose the items. It's like an all-pay auction. I would enjoy it much more if you either succeeded and lost the items, or failed and kept the items. The game would have to be completely rebalanced to make a change like that, but that all-pay mechanism is the main thing keeping me away from this game.
That actually is a good point. I forgot about it, because it would be a thing when... because you were doing most of the challenges, because you just happened to... and you'd be like, I have to go get... this item again, and then we'd have to fetch it for you.
And that's a full, at least one turn, probably two or three.
And when you take into account that there's a good chance, because of the failures, and which happened to me, that someone's going to lose an action, it's sort of just such a... you've lost not just one act turn, in essence, you're losing like three now.
Yeah, and like all the ones you put to get into there, and the ones you're going to have to do to make it up. It is a bummer. I almost want to just try and keeping the items. I mean, it would be a lot easier, but I don't know. It would be interesting to try it out and see
maybe
how you feel.
Maybe you only lose one?
Yeah, maybe you get to choose and you lose half of them. That could be a good house rule. I mean, I don't know. We did almost get destroyed in that game, so making it a little easier might not hurt.
Well, didn't we? We still made it with Scooby, I believe. Didn't we, like,
maybe,
one away?
I think
we were
right.
One away because we just healed everything.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that's still not a huge accomplishment.
Let us know. If you've played Buffy, that's an interesting thing you'd want to try. And so, finally, to close our show, this is something that's been kind of making the rounds lately that I thought was very interesting. Mm-hmm. Battlestar Galactica, the board game, one of our favorite games, one of the first real board games I ever bought that we played together.
Honestly, it's probably one of the best trader mechanic games.
I mean, it really around. Set the standard for that, I for sure. One of the best licensed games as well. And people have noticed online some disturbing things that if you search for Battlestar Galactica on Fantasy Flight's website, you can no longer find it.
Mm-hmm.
And it is no longer listed on their games page. It does still have a page if you go directly to the link, but if you look under the product section, there is nothing there. It's just a page with nothing. So it seems like there's no official announcements. This is all speculation, but it would seem that perhaps Fantasy Flight is pushing Battlestar Galactica out the door, that they're not going to be printing these games anymore. And, I mean, there's a few possibilities as to why they might be doing that. I know I've heard some people say, well, this is a show that's been off the air for a long time. Maybe that's just not
right. And he says, I think I heard rumors about New Angeles, actually, because we have... You haven't played it, right?
I have not played New Angeles.
Yeah, neither of us have played that yet.
I did read up on it a little bit, and it definitely does share some similar mechanics with Battlestar, specifically kind of the skill card stuff, as well as there's a hidden traitor in it. So maybe they're like, why should we pay for this Battlestar license? We own Netrunner and Android. Let's put that out there instead.
I would be now addressing if either of the theories are true. We're going to go for each one. First, the New Angeles one, because it sort of feeds into the other one.
Mm-hmm.
If that's your case, I think that's perfectly fine if it's a literal reskin. Because I feel a lot of what Battlestar does is great to the point that even though I have not seen a single episode of any of the series, the old, new, whatever, you don't need to. You still get the idea of a military command, you know, you get the story,
you get the,
you get the feeling. Of
yeah,
the,
it gives you that atmosphere.
And
right,
the mechanics
away.
Does everything you want from it. I think it's mechanics, it rides on mechanics so well that it does. You're not left out because of the license.
The mechanics are the theme.
Right. Yeah. So it's not like because the show's been off the air for who knows how long. I don't think that's a reason, that's my reason that you don't need to have it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if it comes down to we don't want to pay the license, I mean, sure, don't pay the license. But then bring the game over, like exact copy to just Android Netrunner.
Yeah, maybe they are planning on doing that also. Maybe they have another game in the works.
They may be, and I think that's what they need to do, because, as we said, this game is the setup for a traitor mechanic. Like, it's the best, I can think of long traitor mechanic games.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's definitely, I feel like it's such a staple of a collection. Like,
yeah.
Everybody, if you're a hardcore gamer, should have, or at least have played this game.
I'm trying to think of longer traitor games.
I mean, Dead of Winter recently would be really the big one. Shadows of Camelot, a little bit.
Honestly,
in there. I mean, Shadows of Camelot, I don't think is nearly as good.
Yeah, no, I think this is much better. Dead of Winter, I think, is a fair one. However, I don't. To me, the difference it doesn't feel. To me, it's much. I don't know.
It's different because Battlestar is fully cooperative, and Dead of Winter is more like. Well, I mean, there's a traitor in Battlestar as well, but Dead of Winter, it's a little more sneaky about it. It's like you're kind of working together, but not. Battlestar,
I mean,
it's like...
we had our argument a while ago about that. But I feel like Battlestar, I don't know, it just feels... They don't feel like a copy, clone of each other.
Yeah, I mean, I'm... It's.
And even then, how long ago did Dead of Winter come out compared to Battlestar? Like,
yeah, it's a pretty big gap. There's also, I mean, there's Dark Moon, which was labeled as BSG Express. So that's, again, different, not a long-form game.
But, I mean, it sells. I don't see why Fantasy Flight wouldn't want to sell this game. As we said, the mechanics are amazing.
Well, I mean, I don't have sales reports, so maybe it isn't doing what they want.
Maybe not.
I mean, we've also seen them limiting Star Wars runs, so maybe they're really just, we want to focus on the best and the best only. I don't know, but it's such a shame. It made me think about the kind of the transitory nature of board games, that unlike a movie or a video game or a book, if a company stops printing a board game, it's very hard to get a copy of it. You got to go to the used market, and after 5 or 10 years, you might never see this game again until like you can 3D print or virtual reality them whenever you want.
Well, that's the other thing that's nice about
tabletop simulator. Yeah, for sure.
But I mean,
it's a sad thing to have.
Well, the other thing is like with music, games, movies, because they're digital. You know, technically there can be an infinite number of copies, legal or illegal.
Yeah.
Like, with board games, it's much harder to get a copy. Even if they make it a digital version, I feel like compared to the rest, even though for some things, I know you definitely would agree that you like having a physical copy usually of the items I mentioned before. I don't think that compares to the idea of having a physical copy of a board game.
Yeah, I mean, I think almost all board gamers would agree. They like to own a board game physically. The other thing that kind of bugs me about this is just how
secretive.
Quiet.
Yeah.
I would appreciate if they would make an announcement of whether or not something's happening.
Alas, hurrah.
Yeah, right, if they are going to stop printing it so people can know, like, oh, at this, like they did with Call of Cthulhu, they announced the date when it's going to be ending and how long they're going to print things
right.
for. Let us know, because there's still one expansion for Battlestar I don't have, and I want to know, should I try and get it as
the
fast as I
can? The answer is yes right now. You just should.
Yeah, it probably should. And then I'm like, oh, my copy's getting crappy. I should, like, sleeve it. And I don't know. It's
well,
a whole...
now you know there won't be any more expansions.
No, that's true. I'll have the complete set. We'll see. I don't know. I'm very curious to find out.
Yeah, let us know what you guys think about this, if you knew about it, if you didn't. And...
yeah, if you're worried, if you're from Fantasy Flight and you want to give us an official response, you can choose this as your platform. We'd be honored. Any other questions or comments, we'd love to take them. You can leave them right here on our YouTube channel, where it would also be great if you liked this video, subscribed, told your friends. We're on iTunes as their audio version.
We're also on Twitter, at Roll for Crit, Instagram. We're everywhere.
We're everywhere. Facebook. It's really great. And then there's our website, rollforcrit.com. where we sell games like Battlestar Galactica for now, and many, many more. Plus, we have our links to videos and podcasts and reviews and news. And I think that's pretty much all we need to say.
Yeah.
A lot going on this week.
So until then, I'm Will Keeler.
I'm Jonathan Estes, and have a good one. This is the Roll for Crit, the Roll for Crit podcast.